Thank you, Keith. You're absolutely right. Weather, windy weather, not a factor here today, but we do have our own majestic look at the Canadian Rockies. And below, the Nordic Center here in Canmore, what was once an old mining town, has turned into a winter carnival. The Nordic Center was built at a cost of $15.4 million. Needless to say, it's a state-of-the-art facility. And when the racers ski into the stadium and cross the finish line, they will be greeted by a throng of over 1,000, 10,000 screaming Nordic fans. As you mentioned, Keith, today the first medal of these Olympic Games will be awarded here in Canmore after the women's 10-kilometer race. And perhaps it is fitting that it's Valentine's Day, because these world-class competitors indeed will be skiing their very hearts out. Right now, we're going to shift gears, however, to hockey, and let's go to Jigs McDonald, who's standing by line.
In the starting gate, wearing number 45, representing Italy, Manuela Decentia.
Thank you, Al Troutwig. It is cold, it is a little bit breezy, but if you're the hardy type that enjoys the great outdoors, well, the weather couldn't be more perfect. A marvelous chance to grab a cup of hot chocolate. Sit back, relax, and watch some outstanding world-class Nordic skiers. Today's event, the women's 10-kilometer race, and the first medal of these Olympic Games will be awarded here in Canmore at the Nordic Center. Working with me and serving as ABC's analyst for cross-country throughout the Games, Bill Koch, the only American ever to win a Nordic skiing medal, having done so in 1976 when he captured the silver in Innsbruck, Austria. Billy, also the 1982 World Cup champion. Bill, an outstanding field of women competing here in the 10K, but by far and away the most interesting story, that of the Finnish farm girl, Marja-Liisa Kirves-Niemi.
She's a fantastic story, Mike. She swept the last Olympics completely, and then she decided to take a couple of years off, get married, have a baby, and now she's trying to make a comeback, and she does have the wherewithal to do that. She'll be strongly challenged by her own teammate, Matikainen, and of course the strong Soviet team, and Anjarin.
Well, you know, 10Ks is 6.2 miles if you're not metrically inclined. It's considered middle distance by Nordic standards, but there's nothing middle about it for the women competing. They will be going all out.
Yes, Mike, the 10 is still a full-on sprint. They'll be going all out, and especially today with fast snow conditions, the times are going to be fast, and they're just going to be high tempo from start to finish.
Well, the women have been going all out. However, Marja-Liisa Kirves-Niemi, who was, as we said, one of the favorites, she has not been a factor so far today. Instead, it is the story of some outstanding Soviet ski racers, Bill Koch, that have told a tale. Right now, we are looking at Mario Matikainen about to approach the finish line. Mario, of course, was also a pre-race favorite, 23 years old. In 1986, she was the youngest woman ever to win the World Cup overall title. But there's a look at the leaderboard after 7.3 kilometers, and it is not Matikainen, although she is coming across the finish line now. We must say that all the racers here leave at 30-second intervals, so the race isn't so much head-to-head as it is against the clock, and we're going to get Mario Matikainen's time in just a few seconds here and find out her relative standing to the field. Right now, she crosses the finish line. Let's see if we can get her time. And she has taken the lead. Her overall time after 10 kilometers, 30.20.5. So Mario Matikainen sits in the lead right now. Very, very exhausted woman.
She came on real strong in the end there because she was not very good at the interval timing.
After about 4.6 kilometer, she was not very high in the standings, but she skied a phenomenal second leg here. Right now, let's send you back to Keith Jackson. Keith?
And more. And out in that pastoral beauty today, there is something in the way of a surprise insofar as the women's 10-kilometer cross-country competition is concerned. Let us join Mike Adamley.
Well, Keith, you're exactly right. It has taken exactly one day of cross-country competition to provide our first upset of the Winter Games, and the first medal of the Winter Olympic Games was awarded not to a Finnish woman, not to a Norwegian woman, but to a Soviet woman by the name of Vida Vencina, somewhat of an unknown, 23 years old. I guess she represents the new wave of powerful Soviet skiers. Watch her on the right of your screen wearing bib number 40. She crossed the finish line first in a time of 30.08.3, thus capturing the gold medal, the first gold medal of these Winter Olympic Games. Now, after the victory, there was a special recognition ceremony when Vencina was accepted some roses and the applause from the crowd. Here come the roses. There's the applaud from the crowd. A very happy winner, obviously. Yeah, she will officially receive her gold medal tonight in a special ceremony in Calgary. It did cap off a great day of skiing for the Soviet women. They captured four out of the top five places, followed by Ventsina was Raisa Smetanina. She, of course, 35 years old. This was her fourth Olympics, and she captured her eighth medal. And one of the pre-race favorites, Mario Matikainen of Finland, finished third. So that's the story here in Canmore. Already a big upset. Vita Ventsina, the winner. Right now, let's go back to you, Keith, at the broadcast center. Thanks.
From now on here in Calgary, medals are going to be awarded down at the Olympic Plaza. As I said, a crowd, some 40,000 gathered again tonight as it did last night. It's going to be the real gathering place. The first medal was won by a Soviet, Vita Ventsina.
Vita Ventsina.
Now the Soviet flag being raised and the playing of their national anthem.
Soviet Union for Vita Ventsina, winner of the 10-kilometer cross-country race for women this morning. Then the fireworks, including this day, the first big day of competition, a day of tragedy and a day of celebration. We've said so many times that the Olympics reflect life. More often than not, they reflect the way we wish the world was. Sometimes, in the case of the Jansen family today, they reflect all too clearly the way life can be. Downtown, celebration goes on.